Welcome back to This Week on Staten Island. I'm Bree Driscoll. As we draw closer to the 13th anniversary of the September 11th attacks, remember those who were killed, among them 274 Staten Islanders. Our borough also lost the largest amount of first responders, leaving many young families devastated. Joining me now is Lauren Profeta, who is the Associate Director of Development for the New York Police and Fire Widows and Children's Benefit Fund, and Marcela Leahy, whose police officer husband was killed on September 11th. Thank you so much for joining us. Lauren, let me start with you. What is the purpose of this fund, of your organization?
Sure. So our purpose is very simple. We're here to support the families of police officers, firefighters, Port Authority police officers, and EMS personnel who have been killed in the line of duty. And we do this by providing financial assistance to them immediately upon the loss of their loved one, and then every year for the remainder of their lives.
What sort of things does this money go towards? How does it help people out?
Sure. So, we follow up and we speak to the beneficiaries every year, and they use the money to help pay bills, help pay for college for their children, extra money around Christmas time to do some shopping.
And now, I know that we're talking about September 11th right now, but your organization also helps a lot of people who have lost loved ones more recently, right?
That's true. So we actually were founded in the 80s. So we've helped many families before September 11th, and tragically, we continue to help many families who have suffered a great loss following September 11th.
And you continue to follow these families for years and years and years, correct?
Absolutely. I had one beneficiary send me a picture of her daughter who was starting high school yesterday. So it's really nice to, get to know the families and be with them for the long haul.
What does your organization do on September 11th itself? How does that day change for your organization?
Sure. I mean, this year we're really excited to be ringing the NASDAQ bell and raising awareness for the families that we serve. We're really honored to be a part of BGC and Cantor Fitzgerald's Charity Day to raise some funds for the families.
All right, Marcela, let me bring you in here. Tell me, how did you get involved with the organization? You lost your husband on September 11th, correct?
Yes. Shortly after my husband, we had a memorial service for my husband in October. And it was right around that time, I don't remember the exact, if it was at the service, but I just remember being approached and given financial assistance for the cost of the service from the funds. I've heard about the funds in the past, but I just never, never thought that we would be involved in it in any way. It was a relief, to have that assistance at that time. And then they continue every year, they remember us.
Let me get a little bit of your backstory in here. You lost your husband, and at the time, you guys had three young children. What kind of walk me through what it was like immediately after?
In the beginning, it was more of disbelief. On September 11th itself, I remember I was in nursing school. I was doing my psych rotation, and when I saw the TV monitors, I just thought it was a joke, like some kind of joke or an experiment that they were trying out on the patients, to see how you dealt with trauma, not realizing that this could actually be happening to us. When I got home, immediately the professors released us. I got home and I tried calling James and didn't get an answer. And I figured, oh, he's busy. Of course he's going to be going down there, never thinking that he would have been there. When I got home, played the messages, I found out that he had called from the 20th floor and he said that he was in the building, that it was hit. He said there was a fire in the building. He didn't know exactly what it was, and that he was helping firefighters down. He was on the 20th floor helping firefighters bring people down. He was calm, cool. He said, I'll be okay. Just tell the boys I love them, and I'll see them later.
And at that the time, was the list. How young were your kids?
John was 6 years old, Danny was 13, and James was 18.
So immediately after the death of your husband, you're still, coping with trying to get your young children through this and get through your day-to-day life, right?
It was rough. It was because there was so much going on after 9/11 that you still had hope that they were going to find him. So it was more like we were waiting and waiting and waiting. And then at the time, you have to still, ease the way in. Maybe he's not going to be found. Like, how do we go on from here? We had, plenty of support from family and friends, but at the end of the day, it's still you with the children, and it's hard. Like, for each of them, they grieved in their own way. My youngest one, it was hard for he just kind of made it sound like James wasn't there, mm-hmm. Like he didn't want to accept that he was dead. And it's hard. My oldest was away at college, so we really didn't know how he was dealing with things, so it was more or less phone calls, you know, just trying to see what they needed at that time.
How much did the support from this organization benefit from you? Not only the financial, but you've also made close contact with the other people who have taken part with the organization. How have they helped you to cope with everything?
The organization gives us a network, so you feel like you're not alone. You're with other families that are in the same situation. Not necessarily 9/11, it could be any line of duty death. And you don't feel like you're different than the rest of, you know, the world. You're with other families and children, you know, I'm with other wives and husbands, or, you know, the children are with other children that lost the parents, so they don't feel like they're segregated or they're different. So you have that, the friendships that we built. We built a lot of friendships throughout the organization during the games, the gala. The gala is a one night out a year. We get dressed up and all the, you know, the widows meet and we have a nice night out where you're not thinking about, you know, the day-to-day stress. You're just having a good time and you're there to support the organization who's supporting us.
Lauren, let me ask you, so what events do you put on throughout the year? You were mentioning the gala, but you also do other events, correct?
Sure, absolutely. So we're actually gearing up for this year's gala, which will be on October 23rd. For more information, people can visit our website at www.answerthecall.org. And we also have an annual game, which is a really special tradition for us. It takes place out in Citi Field. Prior to that, it was at Shea Stadium. And we invite all the families to come and just have a fun day at the baseball field, to be around other kids who have been through something similar that they've been through.
Yeah, you were talking about your son, that this event really means a lot to him to go to every year.
It's a highlight because with baseball, because I have three sons and their fault, you know, James was involved in coaching the teams and always at the games, it was a big part of their lives. My youngest son didn't have many years of his father coaching, so it was harder for him, and I didn't realize it in the beginning, it was harder for him to have that love of baseball because he felt like something was missing, his father was missing. So when we go to the game, it was a highlight because he wasn't different than the other boys. He was there, he was having a good time, he was enjoying something that he loved, and it was a relaxed, family-oriented day out where, you know, he, for a moment, he didn't have to, you know, remember that, you know, my father's not here.
Lauren, let me ask you, you know, what do you say to people who say, okay, September 11th was 13 years ago now, you know, we have more pressing issues. Is this a fund that we really need to continue to support?
Absolutely. And these families are still living every day of their lives without their loved one. And I think it's important for all of us to remember that and to honor the sacrifice. Her husband, we lost him because he was going in to save other people. And that's, you know, incredibly heroic. And I think as time goes on, from speaking with many of the families, it actually gets harder. There's milestones in these children's lives. There's graduations, there's weddings, there's, you know, having children of their own. And I think it's very important that we let them know that we have not forgotten about them.
And continue the support system. I know, Marcela, we were talking earlier, your son's getting married. That's a huge milestone. And does that, you know, how is everybody doing now? How are your sons there? It sounds like
everyone's doing well. It's, you know, you have your moments, but everyone at this point is doing really well. My youngest is in Sacred Heart University. My middle son's just took his MCATs, looking to go to medical school. And my oldest is going back to school also to become a nurse practitioner, and he's getting married, so I'm excited. It's grown, you know, the family's growing. I'm getting a daughter finally, so that's exciting. But getting back to, you mentioned about the funds, you know, continuing. It's really important because, like, after James died and, you know, after everyone dies, everyone says, oh, I'm so sorry, we'll never forget. But you think as time goes on, people do forget. And I could say that the fund, they never forget. And I know that if, no matter what it would be, if I called up to just some random question or, you know, I needed something, I know that they would direct me of where I could get that help if they couldn't help me themselves. And
how
it's
important
good to
was
know.
That to you, not only then, but throughout the years, to have that resource?
It's like, you know, that your husband didn't die in vain, that people do appreciate it and people do remember. I mean, we're always going to remember. The family and the friends are always going to remember. But other people, you think they're not going to, but now through this fund, they do remember. And, like, they remember us personally, like, by name. Like, Lauren knows me. You know, we know other widows and other families. And you can say everyone, it's a familiar face. It's like a big family. Even though there's, you know, unfortunately, more people come into the group, which you don't want, but it's still, you're welcoming, and it's a good support group. And it means a lot to know that they're always there.
And finally, Lauren, let me ask you, how have your services for these families changed over the years? You know, I'm sure it's much different than right after the attacks happened.
Sure. So I think our organization has remained pretty steady. Our mission, as I said, is pretty simple. We're just here to be a part of their lives. And so immediately when there is the loss, we provide financial assistance. But as Marcela said, every year following, you know, that day, we've still been here. We're here to provide events, a network of support, financial assistance, and the services kind of grow. Our supporters have grown. We've had one group in Staten Island Go-Karts, reach out and say, how about you invite the kids over, give them a free day at our facility. So I guess, you know, we grow as our supporters grow and as our donors grow, and to meet the needs of the families.
All right, Lauren and Marcela, thank you so much for joining us and telling your story. We really appreciate it. All right, time now for a short break. But when we come back, we're going to introduce you to our Staten Islander of the Week. Stay right here.